Good evening, everybody. My name is Anthony Tamberi, and I'm dean of the John D. Calandra Italian American Institute. There are a number of people to thank for tonight. First, Ernest Ialongo, who decided to take on the coordination and administration of the event. We chatted about what to do, and I asked him if, because he is indeed by trade a historian, and I thought it'd be better for a historian to take control of this, take the reins, instead of someone who does lit crit and all that fancy sort of schmancy interpretation theory. Of course, there are two other people to thank who have made it possible for people to be here. And one is, of course, Natalia. I'm going in alphabetical order here, just so people, nobody gets, you know, upset. Natalia Ndrimi, who is the director of the Centro Primo Levi, and also Robert Miller, who is the editor of Enigma Books. Both of them made sure that certain people would be here, and that's wonderful. I want to thank them for that. Robert Miller, of course, is also the translator, as well as being the director and publisher of Enigma Books. He's also the translator of this book, and we're, quote-unquote, commemorating, if anything, is the appearance of the paperback version. The book originally appeared in English in 2002 in hardback, and at the end of 2015 it appeared in paperback. And Robert's in the back. Thank you, Robert. There are a couple of people who are going to make some comments. I had asked three people to make comments. Two are both from representing the Italian government, so only one of them will make a comment. Our sort of still new director of the Istituto Italiano di Cultura, Giorgio Van Straten, has decided to cede, as they would say in government, cede his 2 minutes to the gentle lady who is our Consul General, Natalia Quintavalle. Prego, Natalia.
Good evening, and as you know, every year on the occasion of the Remembrance Day, il Giorno della Memoria, the Consulate General of Italy, the Centro Primo Levi, the Italian Cultural Institute, La Scuola d'Italia, and three very important cultural institutions, Casa Zerilli Marimò at NYU, Italian Academy at Columbia, and Calandra Institute here at CUNY, Calandra is hosting us today, joined forces to commemorate the victims of the Shoah with a series of very meaningful initiatives. Yesterday, we have gathered in front of the consulate to read the names of the Jews deported from Italy and the Italian territories between 1943 and 1945, following the approval of the race laws. And I would like to thank, really, all the person who stopped there and took the time to renew the commitment to never forget those events. On January 25th, at the Italian Cultural Institute, we have listened to Professor Schwarz, who is here tonight, also talking about Bianca Guidetti Serra and the group of young people who developed their opposition against the fascist regime, and also a strong bond of friendship that linked really very intensely these young boys and girls to each other. On January 26th, at Casa Zerilli Marimò, the screening of the film Oro Macht Frei offered the opportunity for an interesting reflection with Catherine Campbell on the Roman Jewish experience during the Nazi occupation of Rome. Today, we will look into the republishing of Renzo de Felice's The Jews in Fascist Italy, a study of the anti-Jewish persecution in Italy by one of the maybe most controversial scholars of fascism. It's a very difficult task to talk about it, and I'm sure that the discussion will be very, very interesting. I would like really to thank Anthony Tamburi, the Calandra Institute, Enigma Books for organizing this event, and obviously the panelists, Ernest Ialongo, Frank Adler, Stanislao Pugliese, Alexander Stille, and Guri Schwarz. I'm sure that they will guide us in this historical appraisal, and really will help us to have a more clear and objective view of what happened in this period, and especially try and understand how it was perceived, and it has been perceived all along the period from 45 to today by the an historical approach, but also how the different public opinions reacted to the findings of historians in this field. It's a difficult maybe task, but I'm sure that with this rich panel, these very eminent scholars and person who are looking into this period with great, great skill and capacity, and also maybe good feeling for which is the task of an historian today regarding this period. I'm sure that the discussion will be very, very, very interesting. And thank you for being here, and for to all the person who are participating to this series of events, which are really very important for all of us. Thank you very much.
As I call up Natalia Ndrimi, who is the director of the Centro Primo Levi, I just want to say that together with such as Enigma Books and other quote-unquote non-university presses or non-quote-unquote academic, whatever that category is, that last year the Centro Primo Levi embarked on their own publishing project, which I think is extremely important because it's yet another venue in which things that should be published will get published, whereas they may not have gotten published if that venue didn't exist. And we've seen that over and over again, especially with regard to so-called, quote-unquote, marginal, minority, ethnic, whatever you want to call them, groups. And so that's just a little bit of a tanto di cappello to you and to Alessandro for having taken on that project, because it's not an easy project, as we all know. Prego.
It occurred to me today that this is the second event we host that deals with the theme of the tension between historical memory and oblivion and the use of the past. The first one was a very successful event that we organized when the monument to Marshal Rodolfo Graziani was sponsored and built by a small municipality near Rome to celebrate his memory. And as we know, Rodolfo Graziani was a marshal of the Italian army in who, during the Ethiopian War, committed crimes that have later become known to not only to historians and but you know, to the public, and was never charged for them. Among these was the first use of chemical gas on a civilian population. So in a very different vein and with a very different situation, this program also deals with historical memory and is the memory of how the history of the persecution of the Jews was told, was slowly acknowledged and told in Italy. The Renzo de Felice's book, The Jews in Fascist Italy, was originally published in 1961 and was commissioned by the Union of the Italian Jewish Community to a then young historian who had recently taken his PhD and written, I think, only one book, but was not the Renzo de Felice we know of the later years. The Italian Jewish community was looking for a way to have the experience of the Jews of Italy and of the persecution acknowledged in the public forum. And they had, books had been written before and reports had been written before within the Jewish milieu. But at one point they decided that this should be part of the history of Italy and that should be acknowledged outside of the Jewish community. What's interesting about this particular book, in my personal view tonight, is that it was because of this commission that De Felice took on an interest in fascism and became the first major historian of fascism in the country. It was because of the request of a minority that had been persecuted and sought acknowledgement that something opened in the Italian national discourse, and not only the persecution of the Jews, but entire coming to terms with the 20 years of fascist dictatorship came to the public fore. The Felice's monumental work on Mussolini that became the mission of his life, as Consul General Quintavalle said, was controversial to say the least. But above all, it impacted in strongly the Italian political life. And by now, its history and the debate that it prompted, it's itself part of history. Tonight, we are, in a certain ironic way, restaging out of Italy and in some sort of time capsule. I must declare my perplexity when I heard that Renzo de Felice's The Jews in Fascist Italy was being republished anew. We're restaging the Felice debate. And in a certain sense, of course, this is a source of, you know, is an interesting intellectual endeavor. What I think our attention should go to tonight is why are we doing this? Maybe this is the question we ask on the first night of Pesach, of the Jewish Passover. But it is, in a certain way, a question that I've heard from most of the people I've shared the news on this reprint with. Why are we republishing? Why is the Felice being republished today in America? Why is it is this book being promoted as the single most comprehensive study of the Holocaust in a single European nation on the website of the Holocaust Museum? Now, of course, mention should be made that this is a completely outdated book. It's, you know, it's very interesting. It's represented a first step in the opening of the public discourse on the Holocaust, but 40 years of very solid research, opening of archives, understanding of the European context have followed. So at least, it is a question we should ask ourselves. Why are we here tonight to discuss the Felice's book? I'd like to close thanking our speakers, particularly Guri, Schwarz, and Franklin Adler, who came from far away and in the snow and in this winter, for joining this panel, and wish you all a very good evening.
So why this discussion? I think first because this is one of the earlier, more substantial books on the history of Jews under fascism. And I also, I would like to think that I brought to the Calandra Institute a philosophy I learned from an old Italian-American poet who's no longer with us, named Felix Stefanile. He once said to somebody who was engaging in a deconstructive act that was pretty much incomprehensible, he said, there's no ontology without archaeology. And I think that's true. And I think that we need to, and in that spirit, we need to go back and look at things that, as controversial as some people find the book to be, and one of my friends who had written on the book a while back, named Wally Feinstein, stated, critiqued De Felice's technique, as Wiley said, technique of speaking as vaguely as possible of anti-Semitism by using phrases such as anti-Semitic slogans and slanders so as not to be able to dismiss or says so as to be able to dismiss it as non-Italian. This comes from a book that Wiley had published back in 2004. So I for me it was good, a positive thing to do, because it's a constructive thing, because it brings us back to look at seemingly insignificant nooks and crannies. This, of course, is a big nook and a big cranny, but seemingly insignificant nooks and crannies, angles, corners of our history that sometimes we avoid because they are too controversial, because they may bring up some harsh feelings. But I think that, if anything, it helps us also with a certain demythification of that awful, sometimes not awful, depending on who's saying it, phrase, Italiani brava gente. And I think we need to deal with those issues, especially now as, you know, we are 70 some odd years from the end of World War II, and everyone likes to go around and say that Italy hasn't really taken taken account of its fascist period. And so with that, I say let's do it, and let's do it here. So I want to introduce to you Ernest Ialongo, who is going to take over the microphone for the rest of the evening. And I'm going to go back in the back and maybe take some pictures. Ernest is a soon-to-be associate professor of history at Hostos Community College of the City University of New York. And I say that because CUNY has this strange way of first they give you tenure and then they promote you in two different semesters. Call it a double hazing if you wish. He holds a PhD from the Graduate Center, CUNY's Graduate Center in Modern, in Italian. And his area of scholarly expertise is in fact the intersection of politics and culture in modern history. He's the author of Filippo Tommaso Marinetti, The Artist and His Politics, published at the middle of last year by Fairleigh Dickinson University Press. He's also the co-editor of New Directions in Italian and Italian-American History, Selected Essays from the Conference in Honor of Philip Canistrato, which he also organized here at the Calandra Institute. Philip Canistrato, for those of you who don't know, was the first distinguished professor of Italian-American Studies in CUNY and unfortunately left us at an early age. Ernest is also the author of various articles dealing with futurism, politics, and cultural and liberal and fascist Italy. He has presented his works at a variety of national and international venues, and he is also the chair of the Columbia University Seminar in Modern Italian Studies. And besides all of that, he teaches about four courses a semester. Ernest.
This week we commemorate the 71st anniversary of the liberation of Auschwitz-Birkenau concentration camp, specifically the International Holocaust Remembrance Day of January 27th, in Italy known as Il Giorno della Memoria. We remember the millions of Jews, the Romani, the disabled, gay men, and others, all systematically put to death. And we have to continue to ask how it could have happened. Well, this question may seem to be more easily approached when dealing with Nazi Germany, for instance, a country with a history of anti-Semitism, ruled by a party whose ideology was grounded in anti-Semitism. That question becomes ever more difficult when dealing with Italy. There in the 1920s and 30s was a small, highly assimilated, highly patriotic community of Jews who, in 1938, were first subjected to the racial laws which stripped them of many of their rights and means of economic survival. Then, during the war, were arrested and dispossessed of their property and ultimately deported, many to Auschwitz, where few returned. The question, therefore, of Italy's role in the Holocaust has been with us for generations. There have been debates over how anti-Semitic or simply opportunistic Mussolini was, debates over how much pressure Germany put on Italy to adapt the racial laws, or Mussolini simply adopting them to advance his own foreign and domestic goals free of any German pressure. There are debates about the role of the church. How much did Pius XII do or not do to stop the roundup of Jews in Italy after September of 1943, the deportations, and of course, the exterminations? We have had many accounts of individual acts of heroism of priests, nuns, and regular everyday people who sheltered Jews, yet also numerous accounts of informers who betrayed their neighbors and fascist bands who hunted Jews under the Republic of Salò, the Brigate Nere, the Italian SS, and so on. Integral in unleashing these discussions was the appearance of Renzo di Felice's Storia degli Ebrei sotto il Fascismo in 1961, the first substantive work to investigate Italy's state-sponsored anti-Semitism. There were, of course, criticisms at the beginning and in the subsequent editions of the book, which I'm sure the panel will discuss. Susan Zaccardi, in her 1990 review of the fourth edition of the book, noted some of its limitations, but continued to view the book, as a critical contribution to our understanding of fascist anti-Semitism, and wrote, quote, "One could only wish for a translation into English that would make it more accessible to non-Italian readers." Robert Miller of Enigma Books brought us this English translation in 2002 or 2001, depending on which edition you have. And in 2015, a paperback edition was released with a new preface by one of our panelists. Tonight, our panelists will discuss this book, its impact on the field, how the historical literature has developed since Di Felice's book first appeared, and its relevance today. And, as such, let me introduce the panelists in the order in which they will speak. Franklin Adler, at the far end of the table, is the Emeritus G. Theodore Mittau Professor of Political Science at Macalester College, the author of Italian Industrialists from Liberalism to Fascism, and the author of the new preface to the paperback edition of Di Felice's The Jews in Fascist Italy. He is currently at work on his manuscript, Thinking Beyond Anti-Racism. Stanislao Pugliese, next, is Professor of Modern European History and the Queensborough Unico Distinguished Professor of Italian and Italian-American Studies at Hofstra University. He is the author of numerous works, including Carlo Rosselli, The Socialist Heretic and Anti-Fascist Exile, Bitter Spring, A Life of Ignazio Silone, and the editor of The Most Ancient of Minorities, The Jews of Italy. Alexander Stille is Professor of International Journalism at the Graduate School of Journalism at Columbia University, and the author, among other books, of Benevolence and Betrayal, Five Italian Jewish Families Under Fascism. And finally, Guri Schwarz is Professor of Modern Italian History at the University of Pisa, is affiliated with the university's Interdepartmental Center for Jewish Studies, is a member of the scientific board of the Center for Contemporary Jewish Documentation in Milan, and the author, amongst other works, of After Mussolini, Jewish Life and Jewish Memories in Post-Fascist Italy. And so without any further ado, may I ask Professor Adler to come to the front.
Well, thank you. Anticipating Natalia's presence here, I knew the first question she had in mind, which was Manishtana Halayla Hazeh. So why are we dealing with Renzo De Felice at this particular time? Why are we reconsidering a book written so many years ago, which is dated, which has limitations? I'll try to make a case for that, both as a scholar and someone who benefited from the guidance of Renzo De Felice when I did research in Rome, not on this, but on Confindustrium. The first point I would make, I've made before at the Primo Levi Center, is there seems to be a conspicuous gap in Italy today between those who write on the Jewish experience, and the Jewish experience under fascism, and those who more generally write about fascism. Scholars who focus on the Jewish experience, generally speaking, rarely have made contributions to the more general discussion of fascism. My friend Guri, a major exception, and I'll mention an example of that. Scholars who focus on fascism have contributed still less on the Jewish experience. And so we have this odd situation of a category that falls in between these two areas. I will suggest that Renzo De Felice's approach helps bridge that great divide, and that future research in this area would benefit by returning to some of his methodological approaches. Primarily focusing on the changing context of fascist development. Fascism was different in 1919 than it was in 1922, than it was in 1925, than it was in 1929. Than it was in 1935, than it was in 1938. There were different moments of development, And if we're speaking about the Jews, we have to situate especially the racial laws within a particular moment of history, in 1938. Just very quickly, what has been the nature of work on this subject? De Felice's book, as was said, was published in 1961, the first scholarly treatment of the subject. The Israeli historian Meyer Michaelis published another important study in 1978. Much more important, I think, for our concern today, a marvelous new literature began at the end of the 1980s. The occasion was the 50th anniversary of the racial laws, stimulated, supported by a good friend, Michele Sarfatti. And in fact, Sarfatti's criticism of the book I published in the recent issue of Telos, entitled Italian Jews and Fascism. There's also Guri's article that I'll mention in that particular edition. What's so remarkable about this literature is it settled once and for all that this happened, that it was serious. When I lived in Rome in the early 70s, so many times I would hear from other scholars, well, this was never seriously instituted. This was just done to please Hitler. Many of these administrative measures never happened. We know from this research in the 80s, yes, it happened. And in fact, in my view, no piece of legislation in the history of modern Italy was instituted as quickly and as thoroughly as were the racial laws of 1938. For me, that's the enduring importance of the new literature. However, as I said, there is this gap between the literature. We know more than ever before about what happened to the Jews here and the general literature on fascism there. The first question is whether or not Jews in Fascist Italy is a finished scholarly project, or alternatively, whether it's a work in progress. I always regard it as work in progress because it went through many editions. The appendices grew in volume, new documents. And I would consider the work that he did in the voluminous Mussolini biography also a continuation of this early work. I think Natalia was correct. His primary interest in fascism emerged in this study. So much so that Sarfatti in his criticism says, it's strange, how is it a book this title, the Jews in Fascist Italy, is more about fascism than on the Jews? You would think that the Jews would be the primary subject. But De Felice recognized that one had to understand the overarching context in which we look at this problem. And the key players in that were not the Jews. They were Mussolini and those people who ran the regime. The flaws in Mussolini's book became a target for all scholars, I think, from the 1980s on who worked on this, myself included. But I don't look at targets as necessarily a bad thing. In my intellectual life, targets always provided me with stimulation to reconsider, to go beyond, etc. Some of the major mistakes of the text. De Felice argues that the racial campaign against the Jews was the responsibility of a relatively few group of people, Mussolini and members of his entourage. As for why it was instituted, he argued at the time that it was necessary to harmonize relations with Nazi Germany. He never argued, he already knew, that there is no documents that the Nazis demanded this, But nevertheless, if the regimes were to be harmonized, it would be very difficult to have Jews, for example, in the foreign ministry and other ministries who could interact with German ministers. The emphasis in the early book was essentially on external factors, not factors of internal development. The same might be true of Michaelis's study, which is really a study of diplomatic history more than fascism itself. Again, an emphasis on external factors. Revisions of the first edition of the book brought into play his later, more definitive work on fascism. For example, not only in this, but in other areas, he introduced the distinction between fascism as movement and fascism as regime, which played such an important role in the analysis. Most importantly for our purposes was his treatment of the 1930s. The first half of the 1930s, the years of consensus, as he put it, that were based upon radical social change, a critique of capitalism, corporatism, the official doctrine of the regime being the terza via, a third way between capitalism and communism, and also the mass mobilization of Italian society. This is the period in which the GUF, the Italian University Youth, was formed. That included all sorts of famous anti-fascists afterward, like another mentor of mine, Roberto Bobbio, as well as youth organizations of younger children, as well as women, etc. The second half of the 30s, I think, is fundamentally different. Here, there's an emphasis on totalitarian rule. There is colonial expansion, first in Ethiopia, and then involvement in the war on Spain. Not only economic autarky as a result of the sanctions of the League of Nations, but something that I think was far more dangerous, and that is cultural autarky. Cultural autarky. And that is the world of Italian culture fell in upon itself, being highly suspicious of international tendencies in art, especially modernism. As a matter of fact, the work that I'm exploring now is the anti-modernist polemic, 1937, which then morphed into an anti-Semitic polemic. And that is, the Jew was seen as the modernist enemy. Italy had to be protected against the, as they put it, una cultura ibraizzata, a Jewified culture, which was not true Italian culture. And the use of such words as nomadism, snobism, cerebralism, I never heard that before, cerebralismo, and also bourgeois. This was identified with another tendency within fascism, the so-called anti-borghese position. I can't speak now in detail about this comparison between the early 30s and the later 30s. I try to do that at the Primo Levi Center last year in contrasting 1934 Italy with 1938 Italy, but there's no time to go into detail with it now. I have to say this, otherwise someone will jump all over me, and that is, they were gray zones in between. It's not as if the early 30s were non-problematic when it came to Jews. And I'll allude to a number of things. There was the Ponte Trezza affair in 1934, in which anti-fascists were crossing back into Italy with anti-fascist literature. Many of them were Jews, and their Jewish identity was played strongly in the Italian press. There was a list of Jewish authors, l'elenco, that became the title of a book, important book, although important revisions have taken place since that time on censorship in Italy. One could look at the Lateran pacts with the Roman Catholic Church as an important change. And that is, suddenly Catholicism became identified essentially with being Italian. And therefore, if you weren't Catholic, you weren't Italian. The larger point here is that the concept of the Italian people that was promoted in the 20s by people like Gentile was very much an idealist concept, that Italy, that Italians working together and producing something. It was a phenomenological proposition. What happens in 29 and later is that Italian identity becomes essentialized and becomes much more biological, as if now the Italian people are not only Catholic, but they represent a distinct race. What are some of the unresolved problems that we're facing today, those of us who are studying this? And this is important because they're unanswered. The first is, what caused the anti-Semitic turn in 1938? All of us who went to graduate school know that no monocausal explanation of history is worth anything. But three factors are commonly invoked. First, the alliance with Germany. Second, anti-Semitism. Third, the internal dynamics of fascist development. I don't think that anything new will be said about the alliance with Nazi Germany. Not too much has come out recently. And clearly, there were other things as well. In terms of anti-Semitism, I don't want to engage now in a long discussion of this. It was already mentioned that Italy was one of the least anti-Semitic countries in Europe. Of course, all Christian countries had some degree of anti-Semitism, but Jews fared extraordinarily well in liberal Italy, and I would say even in the early years of Italian fascism. So anti-Semitism can't be an explanation. It can be part of the picture. Second, and I think more important and more focused, what was the problem for which the attack on Jews was the solution? What was the problem for which the attack on Jews was the solution? Why did the regime make this midterm correction? The anti-Semitic laws took place after the regime had been in power in 15 years. And I would argue it was clear in 37 and 38 the regime had run out of gas. There was need for a new type of legitimation. This new type of legitimation was not based upon early 30s, that is radical social change, corporatism, but rather nationalism. Emilio Gentile, the historian, calls this an anthropological revolution through a totalitarian state. A new type of Italian would be born. As a matter of fact, the discussions of radical social change like corporatism were put on the back burner. In the press at the time of students and trade unions, this is referred to as the corporatist pause. Corporatist pause. So this radical social change is not on the agenda. But then there's this problem. What happens when there's a political revolution, and there had been a political revolution over fascism, different constitution, different political structures, but no accompanying social revolution? What happens when the regime constantly talks about revolution and change and nothing happens? I would argue that Mussolini is forced to reinvent himself constantly. And when domestic opportunities were limited, he went to Ethiopia. he considered a colonial enterprise. The last problem, yes, the very last problem, is one of continuity versus discontinuity. Did the racial laws of 1938 represent a svolta, a change? Or was it simply a continuation of trends, factors that already had presented itself? For my part, I see no continuous ribbon of logic and events that somehow culminates in 1938 in some type of teleological manner. Anti-Semitism, as I said, was not part of the original program of fascism. So let me return quickly to De Felice. These questions that I raised, that I think we have to confront now, all can be traced back to De Felice's analysis. He didn't do it well. I think he would have been amazed at how much we know about the Jewish experience today. Even when he died, he had no anticipation we would know so much. But it's time now to place this experience in some type of interpretive framework that weaves together the Jewish experience and fascist development. Thank you.
I had the privilege of working with Robert Miller in 1990 as a graduate student at the CUNY Graduate School on this book. In those days before email and cell phones, I received a telephone call asking if I would be willing to work on this project. At that moment, I was finished with my classwork and my exams, and I was looking around for a doctoral dissertation topic. And I had come to De Felice's work, this work, in a roundabout way, because I had been studying fascism and anti-fascism. I had gone to, first, obviously, the other works. I will confess here in public and on camera that I didn't read the 8-volume biography of Mussolini. And actually, I have to tell you, I have no intention of doing that, of devoting a month of my life to that. But I was intrigued by this project. So I would like to talk about it from a personal point of view and what it meant to me as a scholar and what it might mean also to us as just, you know, citizens of a kind of post-Holocaust world. I would like to begin, though, by raising a couple of what might be peripheral issues but are not, because some people already mentioned them. So, for example, why are we here? Not only to mark the occasion of the paperback publication of this book, which, yes, with all its flaws, it's extraordinarily important, but why January 27th? Today, I began teaching a course on the Holocaust at Hofstra University. And I told the students that, you know, January 27th is a Holocaust Memorial Day in Italy and much of Europe, not so much in the United States. And I asked them why. Nobody knew why. I told them, you know, the quote-unquote liberation of the concentration camps at Auschwitz-Birkenau. And even that is problematic in the term of liberation and, you know, the Red Army and all of that. And I had proposed to them October 16th, at least in Italy, as the date which might be more appropriate. Both dates are problematic in the same way, in a certain sense, that De Felice's book is problematic, in the sense that both January 27th, October 16th, the book itself, the Jews are rendered as passive subjects, more or less, to varying degrees, you know. And actually, it was probably Sandro Stille's book in the late 80s where, you know, Italian Jews made their appearance on the stage as active agents with their, you know, own agency and on the stage as characters in their own right. So that's one thing we might talk about later. Another thing is actually later, perhaps in the Q&A, we might bring Robert Miller into the discussion about the actual, you know, the politics and the economics of the publishing industry and why was it that it was something like Enigma Books and Robert Miller that translated this and took this on, this enormous project, and all of that. I, as I said, you know, was a graduate student here in the late 80s and early 90s. I did not have the privilege and the opportunity of working with Phil Canestraro. Ernest did. But the book, when I read it for the first time in Italian at that point, in the great reading room of the New York Public Library, represented, you know, this kind of scholarship. I had known that De Felice, had known the controversy about De Felice, had known about the explosive controversy over the 1975 interview with Michael Ledeen, who actually wrote the introduction to the hardcover of 1991. Robert might talk about that, you know, later. And so I came to the book with already this kind of intellectual baggage or conception of Renzo De Felice. I found it extraordinarily interesting that it had been commissioned by the Union of Jewish Communities, and I was wondering, like, what then is the product? How does that influence the scholarship and the writing of the book? And like, you know, Professor Adler already said, it's kind of strange that although it was commissioned by this entity in Italy, the Jews again appear to be sort of like subjects instead of active agents or the main characters of the book itself. There is this, I had this too, this question of why this passage of the anti-Semitic legislation, why was it in 1938? The traditional answer to that was that, as Professor Adler said, that the regime was seeking a way to revitalize itself when this distinction that De Felice had made between fascism as movement and fascism as regime, as everybody knows, which in itself is controversial, it seemed like the revolutionary aspect of the regime had exhausted itself, and the search for kind of revitalization, new blood, the alliance with Nazi Germany, and certainly the anti-Semitic legislation had something to do with that. Of course, then, you know, the question was, how did this come about? You know that the manifesto of the racial scientists appeared in August of 1938, when most Italians were, you know, either at the beach or in the mountains, and I'm wondering, you know, if that was done on purpose, signed by 12 unknown scholars, academics in Italy, they managed to round up, and what that also meant in the terms of how the racial laws were received. Of course, by the time you get into the fall of 1938, those laws actually were being implemented, and unusual, you know, for Italy, they were actually enforced rather effectively, which tells us something. For me, I eventually ended up doing some work on the movement of Giustizia e Libertà as my doctoral dissertation, and that ended up morphing into an intellectual biography of Carlo Rosselli. I have to say that De Felice has sort of been in a way peripheral to my work, even though I deal with fascism and anti-fascism. His scholarship for us already in the 1990s appeared, maybe Ernest might contradict me or confirm this, for us, Renzo De Felice had already seemed sort of like one of those Oedipal fathers that we had to, you know, symbolically get rid of in more ways than one. Not just his biography of Mussolini, but his interpretation of fascism, and even in a certain sense, this book, which didn't carry the same kind of ideological baggage as the biography of Mussolini and other stuff. There was mention, I just want to mention this very quickly because it's a question of issues of memory and the manipulation of memory, the restoration of memory. Some of you in this room actually participated in this discussion. A few years ago, some folks in Chicago called me up. They had probably seen my work on anti-fascism and thought I might have been a natural ally for a project that they had in Chicago, which was to rename Balboa Drive in Chicago. This is similar to the Graziano controversy in Rome. People had come to the realization that Balboa Drive in Chicago had been named after the famous aviator, the squadrista from Ferrara, and They've probably seen things that Balbo had been implicated in the murder of a Catholic priest and the squads and all of that in the period before 1922. And they called me up asking for my moral support, if you will, of this drive to rename Balbo Drive. And I had thought about this, and in the end, I wrote back to them and I said, I'm not exactly sure it's a good idea to rename Balbo Drive. And I laid out the reasons, which was different from creating a new monument to Rodolfo Graziano. That was something different. That I would have, you know, been again. But what I was arguing was that by renaming Balbo Drive, it was an erasure of a certain moment of, in this case, Italian-American history, when Balbo had flown from Italy to Chicago for the Great Expedition, sort of like an Italian response to Charles Lindbergh and all of that. And this sort of problem, you know, persists, not just with the proposed monument to Graziano or Balbo Drive, but for memory in general, you know. And I realized this even more so today in the first day of class, because as I told my wife, as I was walking out the door, I'm always enthusiastic about the first day of class, but I'm also sort of like depressed by the end of the day, because I find I'm a year older and the students are always 18. And so when you say that we are now at the 70th anniversary or whatever it is at the end of the Second World War, and for students that, you know, who are 18 years old, that, you know, Ronald Reagan is already ancient history, then that sort of lays out the dilemma of the historian, even for historians who do, you know, work in the 20th century. I would like to conclude by picking up on something that Anthony had said. He had quoted the poet Felix Stefanilli, who said that there is no ontology without archaeology. If that's the case, we can probably say, I would say in conclusion, that the Felice book, with all its problems, which even with the problems are like generating historical work, you know, and historiographical work. So the De Felice book, not just this one, but his entire corpus of his entire work, is now, for better or worse, part of our ontology and part of our archaeology as scholars of Italy in the 20th century. So, thank you.
I think one has to consider this book in two different, or a few different contexts, because there's the book that was published in 1961. There was the re-edition in 1987. There is the current edition, and the context has changed when the book came out, as people said. This was an important landmark work. It vastly upgraded our knowledge, not ours, because I was barely functioning then, but the world's knowledge of this important dark chapter. And so it was really an important book. The edition of 1987 is already different. There was quite a bit more information available. De Felice was by then the controversial biographer of Mussolini, who had a whole series of methodological and ideological bones to pick, which he picks a little bit in the updated edition. And then there is, what are we to make of it now in the light of another 50 years of scholarship? One thing I think to be said for the book, to answer Natalia's question of why, like almost everything of De Felice, this book is itself a kind of portable archive. The strength, and I would argue also limitation, of De Felice is that he was a total document hound, and he jams each of his books full of documents. And for others, this is enormously useful. There is an enormous amount of stuff in this book, and it remains an important and arguably indispensable book because of that document-heavy approach. One can get a lot out of it, whether you agree with everything that De Felice does. And so I think it's still a book that you have to consult and that you would want to consult if you're working in that period. At the same time, I think a lot of the flaws and the limitations of the book are more evident now than before, I already felt, Stan sort of alluded to this, when I began working on this period in the mid-80s, one of the things that struck me, I mean, it's one of the things that still strikes you, De Felice's work is almost always top-down history. He's not interested in little people. He's interested in institutional players and how they interact with one another. So he's interested. This is a book that to some degree reflects its origin, commissioned by the Union of Jewish Communities, and so a lot of the book is about the both what the regime is doing, as people have said, very much about the fascist regime itself, and then to some degree its interaction with the recognized institutions of the Jewish community, namely the Union of Jewish Community. In that sense, that represents a limitation because one doesn't get there's very, very little about how ordinary Jews experience this period. Natalia mentioned there are no women in the book. There are no ordinary people in the book to speak of. And so this kind of document-centered approach can also be somewhat misleading because what the OVRA tells Mussolini about what's happening in the Jewish community isn't necessarily what's happening. One has, and is interesting to read, the ceremonies that occur, let's say, on the so-called Giorno della Fede, when all of the churches and synagogues celebrate the conquest of Ethiopia. But when I went to talk to people, and of course these sources are also to be taken with caution, a lot of people would tell you that they went to the ceremony, but they put a cheap $2 gold ring into the basket for the thing, and they kept their real wedding ring at home. Some of those stories are certainly true. Some of them may be after the fact inventions. But all that sort of lived and contradictory experience is missed in this book. The other thing that is striking in the book, Professor Adler mentioned it briefly, and I was kind of rereading the book in preparation for this evening, after having read and reviewed the David Kurtzer book on the Pope and Mussolini, I thought, what did De Felice do with the Lateran Pact in this? It's been a long time since I'd read the book. It is literally not mentioned. It is shocking. It's just shocking that this event that clearly is a huge turning point and an enormously studied strategic move on the part of the regime, which essentially demotes the other religious groups in the country to a second-class status, is completely ignored. The first reference that at least I can find in the index to Pius XI is page 292, I think, and that's at the time of 1938 when the racial laws are passed. So that is like an enormous chasm in this account. And the other obvious deficiency is that De Felice barely considers the period after July of 1943, when the regime falls, so that the period of the Repubblica di Salò is covered, and in which the most terrible things happen to Italian Jews, is covered in a mere 38 pages in this edition. And I think most of us with a historical perspective would give more space and more weight to that part of the story. And I think this then goes to another thing that is one of the central problems with De Felice's work. People have mentioned the controversy surrounding his Mussolini biography. And people, I think, often unjustly accused De Felice of being a kind of apologist of Mussolini. And he was furious of that. He had had his own personal ideological transformations. He began life as an Italian communist and then evolved, as often happens, former communists are then the most virulent anti-communist, and then his old comrades were attacking him, so he sort of doubled down on his positions and became very embattled. And I think that the problem is actually not so much that he was pro-fascist, but that his very historical approach led him in a certain direction. This reliance, very, very heavy reliance on the documents, and in particular the documents in the Archivi di Stato, meant that he became a little bit of the prisoner of his own methodology, the prisoner of his own sources, and so that without necessarily intending to, in doing a biography of Mussolini, he was doing something of an autobiography of the fascist regime, because 90% of the documents in that biography, I haven't read all 8 volumes either, Stan, but I did pick my way through parts of a few of them, and they're overwhelmingly from the Archivi di Stato, and that inevitably conditions what you get. You don't get other voices. And that's true to a degree in this book as well. One of the things that's also curious in the way in which the later De Felice then to some degree conditions the book that we have in our hands, there's a curious thing in the book, I think very wisely reproduces the introduction that De Felice added in the 1987 edition, which has a passage which always puzzled me when I saw it for the first time, because I had read an earlier edition of the book when I began working on it. It was before 87. And this, in this introduction, De Felice says that one of the things he changed in the book was he removed, there were various sort of expressions of indignation and moral disapproval that he then edited out of the later edition because he felt it was somehow inappropriate and unscientific to do that, which I found very strange because I remember reading the earlier edition and finding some of these, they were rather subtle and small, but well, why shouldn't one be indignant if people are robbed of their civil liberties or mistreated, doesn't seem. And part of that has to do, and De Felice uses in that thing, and he used at various points in his different interviews, he was very wedded to this idea of I'm a scientific historian. Everybody else are a bunch of amateurs and political score settlers, but he is, and one of the things that's kind of funny, if you read the 1987 edition, he's already adopted the royal we. We decided not to revise this. We, who's we? It's I. And so part of this thing of having become a monument is this idea of that that history can be a scientific enterprise, that the historian can truly detach himself from his time, from his methodology, is, I think, an enormous illusion that, in fact, De Felice, like any of us, there are biases that are built into the choices we make as historians, into the methodology we choose, and so that by privileging the documents of the regime, that's a choice that you make, and you get certain results from that choice. By choosing to ignore, for the most part, the period of the German occupation, that's a choice that has important consequences. And it relates to one of the big sort of themes, and this, I think, goes to one of the points that Professor Adler made, this question of continuity, lack of continuity. How is it that the anti-Semitic laws came about, and why did they happen in a country that was, comparatively speaking, far less anti-Semitic than most? And of course, De Felice, particularly in the Mussolini book and in the interviews he gave, the first one with Ledine and the later one with, I think, Pasquale Chiesa, was obsessed with his idea, and it's in the 87 introduction, that it annoyed him enormously that people were constantly putting together Nazi Germany with fascist Italy. Now, of course, there are good reasons to want to distinguish between these two things, and they are separate historical phenomena. But De Felice becomes sort of obsessed with this point, in which he denied that there was any kind of family resemblance between these movements, that for some reason one group had black shirts and the other had brown shirts, that it was just accident, that they both ended up on the same side in the war, and they ended up participating jointly in the rounding up of Jews in Italy in the latter part of the war. But he's obsessed with this idea of wanting to keep these things completely separate. And And while I and Professor Adler mentions, and De Felice mentions, he has this idea that, well, there really wasn't anti-Semitism in fascism from the beginning. And while that is somewhat true, I think it can be overemphasized. And I think that while I tend to think actually that external influences, particularly the thrust for empire and the alliance with Hitler, the decision to go to war, were determinant in Italy's decision to adopt racial laws, I think that these things don't come out of nowhere. And so that, for example, in in 1919, and De Felice quotes this, at the time that the Russian Revolution and Civil War is going on, Mussolini wrote a famous article in which he attacked world Jewry as the soul of both Bolshevism and capitalism. And I quote, "If Petrograd does not fall, if Denikin gives up, this is what the big Jewish bankers of London and New York want. Tied through their race to the Jews in Moscow and Budapest, they are taking their revenge on the Aryan race that has was done to them by being scattered for so many centuries. 80% of the Soviet are Jews. Could Bolshevism be the revenge of Judaism over Christianity? Would world finances in the hands of the Jews?" And so forth. And now Mussolini changed his position on this, as he did on so many issues, and he reversed course. Opportunism is, I think, if you're uncertain about his motivation for most things, opportunism is usually your best bet, because he then changed his tune on this thing to write that the Bolshevik Revolution was not a Jewish thing. But the idea that that it existed in his mental baggage, Mussolini was a superficially educated autodidact who absorbed, who loved these kind of easy categories. So the English were a decadent race that took tea at five and could never adequately defend themselves. The Jews were unusually clever and good at finance. He and interestingly, but I think to write a passage like the one I read means you have to have these categories in your head. You have to absorb certain kind of stereotypes that I think were in the culture. De Felice refers to this, and I quote, "The oversimplification of this view is obvious, but to refer to that sort of anti-Semitic creed as an oversimplification is to put it in oversimplification." He then goes on to quote another, Mussolini then corrected his aim by writing a piece some months later in which he said, "In Italy we make absolutely no difference between Jews and non-Jews." But in that same piece, Mussolini goes on to write, "Let us hope Italian Jews will continue to be intelligent enough not to provoke anti-Semitism in the only country where it has never existed before." And that, of course, is a not so subtle warning to say, okay, you don't have anti-Semitism here, but we might. So you have to be good, you have to be good fascist, and if you're not, there may be trouble. And what that's suggesting is that the Jews are accepted citizens, but they're citizens on a kind of probation in which as circumstances change, their condition can be changed. And so I think it's important to, when considering this problem of continuity, not continuity, while I very much agree that the need to reinvigorate the regime in the late 30s is really important and helps to explain things. But at the same time, I don't think you can create something out of nothing. There has to be something to work with in the culture, and there was something. And Mussolini would activate it or deactivate it at given moments. We mentioned the Ponte Tresa incident. There was this set of mental categories and cultural tropes that could be brought out as needed and were brought out repeatedly that were part of the culture of fascism. And then to conclude that I think that also, I think it's Adrian Littleton in the Seizure of Power book says that fascism is fundamentally unstable and therefore needs projects like this, because if you're just kind of spinning your wheels at home, why are we without liberties, why are we in the regime that we're doing? And so the invention, and Mussolini mentioned this, he said, you know, after the invasion of Ethiopia, I'll have to come with something else, and so we're going to intervene in Spain. After that, I'll come up with something else. This kind of restless seeking of external projects to use as a safe, as sort of safety valves for the regime is there, but also in the dream of empire, race is inevitably part of it. The regime already in 1933 passes norms to regulate the interaction between blacks and whites in Libya, or Italians and Libyans, so that part of that project is sort of there. And I think finally, in the end, I end up more in the camp that without the decision to go to war, they might not have gone down this course. But that became almost inevitable given the course that Mussolini had put the country on, and therefore it's a combination of internal and external factors that I think account for what happened. Thanks.
I have to start by getting back to a name that was just mentioned, that of Adrian Littleton. Adrian Littleton was one of my main mentors, and just before I came here, we were talking about something else, and I told him I was coming here. He had seen the program, the seminar, and he said, "You feel like a Martian, like Flaiano's Martian in Rome." I don't know if you know about it. There's this short story about Baglino Flaiano, in which he brings this upturning of the perspective. He describes Rome from the point of view of a Martian, and how a Martian would see a Roman, contemporary Roman, Italian politics, culture, behaviors. And well, I must say, to a very high degree, Adrian was absolutely right. He was prophetic in many ways. And we often say we live in a small world, and it's certainly truer and truer. And at the same time, for me tonight, the distance, the Atlantic was incredibly wide. No discussion like this could be imaginable in Italy today about De Felice's book. You could have a historiographical discussion about De Felice's book between 5, maybe 10 scholars, with a public of 5, maybe 10 graduate students, all very detailed, all very scholarly, but certainly, and this is to go back to Natalia's original question, why are we here? I don't think that anybody in Italy would think today that De Felice's book can be considered the reference work for the history of the Holocaust and racial persecutions in Italy. I really, really have trouble imagining anybody, even the most fierce defenders and heirs of De Felice, would not even try to make that case for a series of reasons. One of the reasons why I felt to some degree a Martian tonight is that it was mentioned in Stille's talk right now, but only briefly, politics. We were talking about De Felice's book as if it was written relatively recently by a man who's just thinking about the past. We are instead talking about a man who lived intensely Italian political and cultural life, and for whom it was really, really hard to discern where political struggle ended and when historiographical battles began. The borderline is quite porous, But before I get to that, and that is really a key point, and it is a key point for us to understand that all the seasons and phases of this book. This book has a long history. Some of the editions were mentioned, but we must remember there were many more editions. The first 61, the second 62, and here politics comes into play. Why make a new edition 1 year later? for a very simple reason. This book, when it was published, produced a huge scandal in Italy, not about Jews, not about fascist anti-Semitism, but for one name in one tiny footnote. Because he said that the secretary of the radical party, Leopoldo Picardi, had participated in a reunion between Italian fascists and German Nazis about racial policies. It was an uproar, newspapers, political battles. Picardi had to resign, and if you look at the documentation of the time, you see people like Ernest Rossi asking themselves, for who is working De Felice? Why does he put Picardi's name there? He knew that something would come up. And Ernesto Rossi also writes in his letters to several members of the radical party at the time, and he says, why doesn't he write about Amintore Fanfani, the leader of the Christian Democrats, who also was an active young man who wrote racist propaganda. Why doesn't he write about Massimo Firpo, the scholar in Turin, and so on and so on and so forth. This book and De Felice's work, and you can really read all the stages as chapters that allow you to get into the Italian political and cultural battle. To read this book, I think today, and we mentioned the value of archaeology, is a trip down the archaeological reading of Italian cultural and political struggles, not into what the history of fascism or anti-Semitism was. It's really a completely different game. So, first of all, this book was perceived as a political attack. And so he had to publish a new edition taking out the name. That's why the second edition, the only difference is one name taken out. And it's interesting, there's no debate about the contents of the book in 1961. The only consequence is Leopoldo Picardi has to resign from the secretary of the Radical Party, and Renzo De Felice is punished by the academic establishment, because he has done something wrong. So he will not get a chair for a few more years in the university. He has a concorso and he loses, and if you go read the writings of the members of the commission and his own writings with Delio Cantimori, who was a powerhouse in the Italian academic system and the reference point for De Felice, Cantimori tells him clearly, look, you won't win. I will do my best, but you won't win. They have to punish you. And really, once again, if we have to look at this book, it's as a prism through which we can penetrate Italian political culture, if you want, academic struggles also. And De Felice at that time was certainly not willing to be in the crossfire. Later on, he played another game. He was the one in power, leading academic battles and managing positions all over the country. So, 62. The next edition is 73. I don't think anybody mentioned it. That's a key new edition of this book. That's where he introduces one new element that for us is obvious. In 73, De Felice understands that, well, maybe colonial racism had something to do with the beginning of the racial laws in 1938. That wasn't really a point that was present in the 61 edition. And it comes out only in 1973. But this is a minor, if you want, historiographical issue. The big point for me is that this book we're seeing here is, we were talking before about agency. How much time does it take to write this, to do the research and write it? It took De Felice 10 months in total, from the beginning of the research to the publication of the book. It's, I don't know, incredible. And how is it possible? We were talking before about a Jewish agency. Well, it's not just that the Union of the Italian Jewish Community commissioned the book. They commissioned the book, they paid him, they paid the publisher, they made political pressure to guarantee him special access to the archives. They brought to him the microfilms and the synthesis of the each issue of periodicals like La Difesa della Razza, who were written down by a man like Massimo Adolfo Vitale, who had been working for the Union of Jewish Communities since 1945 to look at the beginning for the survivors, for those who had been deported, and to look at what happened to them. And then who started in his own way writing a history of Italian Jews. So he was given a huge amount of support that allowed him to write this book incredibly quickly. And this book is really the product of a huge effort, which doesn't start that in that day. Actually, if you look at the archives and the documentation, I actually wrote about it, but a long time ago, but it's maybe useful to remember it. The Union of Italian Jewish Community poses itself the objective of having a history of persecutions written in May 1945. It takes them 15 years to have it done for several reasons. For a moment, they think in the 50s they found the right person in Antonio Spinoza. One of the reasons is they want a non-Jew to write it, okay? It's very important for them that a non-Jew writes it. At the same time, it's tricky. They want their story, their drama, their pain to be told and made public, but they cannot challenge what is at that time, in the post-war, certainly in 1961, and to a very high degree until the late 70s and early 80s, the dominant narrative that is lays at the heart, at the foundation of the Italian political and cultural system. The idea that Italy is an anti-fascist nation, that fascism is an accident, a parenthesis, something that is totally unnatural, unrooted, and with no relationship to Italian history. And that was the dominant narrative, and you couldn't challenge that. Certainly a tiny minority couldn't challenge that. So how do you bring attention to your history of persecutions and not challenge that narrative? It's very hard to combine the two, because if you want to bring to the forefront how Italians, not Martians, but Italians, persecuted Jews, it's hard to give that the necessary emphasis if at the same time you cannot challenge the idea that the real Italy is anti-fascist Italy. So they're kind of caught in a trap here. And this book, especially in its 1961 edition, is a clear evidence of that trap. So it's a book about fascist anti-Semitism, Italian anti-Semitism, okay? And at the same time, it's a book that has to contain a series of statements that declare that Italy and Italians and Italian culture and the true spirit of the nation are actually blameless. It's a contradiction. If you write a book on a subject and at the same time you say, really, the subject is not there because it's a tiny minority, Mussolini and a group of acolytes, but you know, Italians. But that was the unavoidable trap in which De Felice found himself when he accepted to write this book. And it's understandable in 61. In 1961, De Felice was 29 years old. He was unemployed. He had just attempted to get a position in the Central State Archives. He came out last at the concorso. So he didn't get the job. And so he gets this position through a complicated, intrigue of personal connections that leads finally to him. He's certainly not a specialist of this subject, nobody is. And he is unavoidably set inside that trap. You're putting an emphasis on something that is Italian responsibilities and fascist racism, that's the political objective of the Union of Italian Jewish Communities, and at the same time, you cannot really say that, because you still have to confirm that the true Italy is anti-fascist Italy. And you see that very clearly in a certain point. At page 467 of this edition, you have a quotation that is there since the first edition, since the edition 1961. It doesn't change throughout 61, 62, 73, 88, and then the 1993 edition. It's always there, and it's understandable for the first edition, much less for the last ones. So it's the last pages. He's talking about what happened under the Repubblica Sociale Italiana. He's talking about the Jew hunt, how finally fascists and Nazis collaborated in arresting, deporting, and finally sending Jews to death. And he has to elaborate an overall judgment of that scenario. That's the most delicate point for the clash between those two levels that I talked to you about, and the unavoidable clash with the dominant narrative, the anti-fascist narrative. And so what does he do? He chooses to quote a speech by the president of the Union of Italian Jewish Communities made in 1956. Now, and let me just read a few lines. Sergio Piperno, who was the president, at an official ceremony at the Capitol in Rome, declared, "Everyone helped us. Everyone helped. All those who in some way could follow the moves of the occupying power and its collaboration and its collaborators were quick to warn their innocent and, marked victims. All the friends, the acquaintances, the neighbors were quick to take them in, hide them, and help them. Everyone labored at procuring false documents for the Jews and derailing the searches." It's obvious that it couldn't be everyone. Otherwise, everyone would have survived, okay? And this is the trap I was talking about. And why do representatives of the Italian Jewish institutions say these things? Because they're in that trap. For them to relate to the state and to the institutions, here it's he's speaking at a public conference with a mayor, with political representatives from all parties in a very official ceremony. They have to say these things. There is no other way. And it's clear that De Felice, 29 years old, unemployed, who's commissioned to write this book, is obviously led to follow that path in 61. It makes sense. De Felice in 1988, everybody here before talked about 87 edition, it's actually 88. The preface is dated December 87, but the book comes out in 88. Sorry, it's a tiny obsessive fixation. But in 1987 or 88, De Felice was the most powerful academic in Italy. He had no problems, and what he was doing since several years was actually challenging that same national myth about the anti-fascist Italy as being the true Italy. So there, it doesn't make sense. Why keep it there in 1988? Why keep it there in 1993 edition? It makes sense for another reason. And here you have another contradiction that relates, once again, not to what happened in Italy between 1938 and 1945, but to Italian political and cultural battles and to the role played by De Felice. So the preface is dated December 1987. Now, a series of things happened in December 1987 in Italy. First of all, for the first time, Bettino Craxi, the secretary and charismatic leader of the Italian Socialist Party, meets publicly with Gianfranco Fini, the young secretary of the Movimento Sociale Italiano, the neo-fascist party. It provokes a scandal. Why? Because you do not relate to the fascists. They're there, they can have their representatives in parliament, but they're not someone you talk to. They're not someone with whom you share designs for constitutional reform, electoral reform, and all the big issues that Caxi discussed with Fini in that winter of 1987. So it's winter 1987, this happens, and it is part actually of a movement that goes on since several years by the Italian Socialist Party and Craxi to get rid and to, well, get rid is an oversimplification, but to readjust the relationship with the anti-fascist narrative, to open up to the neo-fascists and to insert them into what is called the constitutional arch. And the basic argument, there's, if you read the socialist newspapers and their journals and the writings of their key intellectuals at the time, what they say is basically anti-fascism is an instrument for the communists. We don't need it anymore. okay? The world has changed. We have to plan a new republic. We're going to make a constitutional reform. And we need to start from scratch, getting rid of the old prejudices. This formula comes out very, very often in socialist press between 85 and 87. Now, in December 87, so De Felice hands in the revised manuscript of this book to Einaudi. And on 27 December 1987, he is interviewed by Giuliano Ferrara on the Corriere della Sera. And the interview is published on the first page. An interview to a historian published on the first page of the major newspaper, it's not really, really common. And the title of the interview is De Felice, why do we have to get rid of the anti-fascist rhetoric? And the whole interview is an effort by Giuliano Ferrara to relate to De Felice, to talk without mentioning it, about the Fini Craxi scandal, okay? And it's a long interview. It causes a real uproar. You have tens of articles and huge debates. And then there will be a second interview by Ferrara to De Felice on January the 8th. I cannot go into that in detail. But there are a few statements in this interview that tell us what this book is. This one here that we have now, which is basically the 88 edition, because in 1993 he basically added a few footnotes and a slim introduction. And that edition relates to that political moment and that specific climate. So, Ferrara asks him, until yesterday, we thought that anti-fascism would survive the test of time. Isn't it so anymore? And De Felice, ideally, yes, this is the basic founding element of our republic. But in practice, it was built on nothing different from the old Giolittian and liberal state, maybe with a little maquillage. And the innovations introduced by fascism in the Italian social, political, and economic system have survived in the Italian Republic, even though they were cleansed somehow by the new democratic system. Of course, the fascist leadership was totally illiberal. But are we sure that it was so much worse than the current political leadership? And then he goes on, fascist bureaucracy had a sense of state that we had lost. And again, and here is the key point. You see, if we want a new republic or a big reform, it has to be something serious. And then it's important that we break radically with the past on an intellectual and symbolic level. Craxi is one of the few political leaders that understood this, and so on and so forth. Now, and he goes on to add the key formula that I mentioned before. A new republic cannot be founded on the prejudices of the old republic. So the new republic cannot be an anti-fascist republic. And how does he justify that? Okay, what is a key argument he uses? And that is completely unexpected to many at the time, but it tells us a lot about this book. And so Ferrara fakes to be shocked and says, Professor, you realize generations of Italian will be traumatized by your words, okay? And in the grand finale, De Felice says, it is logical that we get rid of the alternative between fascism and anti-fascism. I am and have always been a historian of fascism. Here he puts his academic cap on, which gives him authority. And what does he do with that? Italian fascism is outside, is free from the, it cannot be accused of genocide. It's outside of the cono d'ombra, the shadow of the Holocaust. In many ways, Italian fascism has been better than the French or Dutch fascism. Nobody knows why he thought about Dutch fascism at the moment. So the main justification, yes, I'll steal you a few minutes, but yeah, I'm closing. The main justification that he brings for a radical break with the past in political, constitutional, cultural terms is that Italian fascism was not anti-Semitic, that they didn't really persecute the Jews, okay? So this is not a book about fascist anti-Semitism. This is a book, especially in the 87 edition, that tells you about the Felice and political and cultural battles in late 80s Italy, which is quite fair, because each of us as a historian unavoidably is in a constant dialogue with the present. De Felice's dialogue was a bit more personal and intense than that of most historians with the political sphere, but we cannot forget about that. And I have really a lot of, it's really puzzling for me how that debate, which is light years away from Italy today, can be relevant here in any way. Because outside that debate, this book is truly, from an academic point of view, irrelevant today. This book was thought in 1961, rewritten basically in 1988. Since then, you have almost 30 years of historiography that completely revises a whole series of issues. De Felice says that the racial laws were not fully implemented, and it was proven false. De Felice says it doesn't have a foundation in Italian cultural and scientific debate, and so it was proven false by a series of books. And I could go on for an hour to list all the things. I've made a test the other day. We could call it a silly exercise in quantitative history. In 1993, I think, Mario Toscano, who's a pupil of De Felice, counted how many books or articles were published in Italy on these subjects between the early 80s and the early 90s. And he arrived at the conclusion that it was more or less 10 times as much as what was published between 1945 and 1980. Now, if we count how many things have been published since 1990 and today, it's 30 to 40 times as much as what was published between 1980 and 1990. Now, either all that bibliography is irrelevant, or it's really, really hard to think of this as a textbook that you can give to a student to understand what fascist anti-Semitism was. You could use it for a fascinating seminar about memory, politics, academic battles, I guess for advanced graduate students, but I don't know how many there are that are so passionate about the background struggles of Italian politics. So I want to thank you again. It's really interesting for me and to be here, and that's it.
I heard a few questions about why I published the book, why I translated the book, how did it come about. Well, around 1999, I decided to create this publishing house in order to publish important documents on the Second World War. That was the first iteration. And in looking around, I found that nothing of De Felice had been translated. And I thought De Felice was a representative figure of Italian historiography and should be translated and known to English speakers. So I took on the challenge and spent 14 months translating the book. You asked also, why did Michael Ledeen write the first introduction? Well, I saw that Michael Ledeen had interviewed De Felice in a book called Intervista sul Fascismo. And I went looking for him, and I found that he had been thrown out of the US government and had lied to Congress and was now working for the American Enterprise Institute. So I went to see him in Washington, and we talked, and he told me, oh yes, I worked with De Felice as a student for a very long time, because I was sent there by George Mossy from the University of Wisconsin, and that De Felice encouraged him, and basically that's how this book interview on fascism came about. So I said to myself, well, here's Ledeen. He spent several years with De Felice. He must know the guy, and probably he's the best person to write an introduction. Well, I was very much criticized for that choice, and I didn't know Franklin Adler at the time. So now that I finally found the right introducer, I'm very grateful. Thank you.
I have a question for Guri Schwarz. One thing that I think is striking rereading this text of De Felice is his extremely abstract concept of what the Jews are and what the Jewish institutions are. And these two things don't seem always clear and seem loaded with other ideas. I was wondering if De Felice in the book, and which I didn't find in other studies, had an understanding of what Uchi was, and that in some ways it was the product of the repression.
First of all, it is his relationship with the commissioning agency, the Union of Italian Jewish Community, is very complex. So they commission the book, then they tell him, as you write, you will be followed by Massimo Blurfo Vitale, who will give you documents, he'll give you all the material he gathered in 15 years of a life's work. And as you write the chapters, you send each one of them to Dante Lattes. Now, Dante Lattes was one of the founders of Italian Zionism, religious Zionism, and in the post-war, he was the head of the Educational Cultural Institute of the Union of Italian Jewish Community. He wasn't a historian, but he was a protagonist of at least a little bit of this history. He was there. He lived through those years. He's also mentioned, I think, by De Felice when he talks about, I don't remember in what edition, when he talks about the trip that Mussolini asks Angelo Orvieto, and I think, no, it's Viterbo, it's not. Anyways, he's mentioned somewhere in there about Italian Zionists and Italian Jews. Now, if you look at the correspondence between Lattes and De Felice, which you can find in the archives, and I've looked at several years ago, it's very interesting. Lattes is obsessed with one thing. He wants De Felice to stress that Zionists were anti-fascists, which is basically not true, okay? For a whole series of obvious reasons. Zionists were Zionists. they had another agenda. But in post-war Italy, for Lattes, that was the important thing. Nothing else, really. He also intervenes a couple of times about the struggle inside the Union Italian Jewish Community between the so-called bandieristi, the group of organized fascist Jews, and the institution. He wants to, you know, hush things down, basically. And it must be said to De Felice's account that he resisted these pressures. And he wrote, if you look at the version that he sent to Lattes and the version he published, he basically wrote what he thought was right. Does he really understand how it works? One of the problems with this book is that De Felice talks about Italian Judaism as if it were a political party. It wasn't a political party. De Felice is trained as a historian of political parties, academically. He thinks that way. That is his way of interpreting dynamic. Alexander Stille said he writes top-down. In writing top-down, he's writing as Italian historians of political parties do, thinking about the hierarchy of the party and how it transmits its orders and so on and so on. The Union of Italian Jewish Communities simply was not like that. It was a fragmented mess of people with very, very different opinions. So, yeah, basically he has trouble with that. I must also say that's not the biggest issue I would have with De Felice, so.
So my question, when I was asked in or told by my college professor in 1985-86 to do my thesis on Marinetti, I was absolutely shocked that there seemed to be no secondary sources, and you know, the whole thing, the whole cultural side of fascism was very taboo in Italy. And then, you know, when I was in Italy, it became clear to me that, you know, the phrase, before the war, everyone was a fascist. After the war, everyone was an anti-fascist. And, you know, all the kind of embarrassment and the confusion and, you know, those years of how are we going to get around to talking about this in Italy. And then I had some sort of firsthand historical information because my mother-in-law later on, my mother-in-law, I married an Italian, and my mother-in-law, whose aunt was was married to Nello Rosselli, and so she and her father were two of the many, many Jews, I think around 32,000 Jews, that were actually saved by Christian Catholic Italians who were risking their lives and so on. My question is whether it's possible that within Italy, the story of the memory needs to be told more, and the, you know, the Jews and the victims, and whether outside of Italy, the story of the survivors needs to be told more. You know, because I think there's been two different kind of views of the question, one from inside Italy with all of that embarrassment, and one from outside Italy with, well, you know, over here in America, we're looking at Mussolini and equating him with Hitler, we don't have really much of an understanding of what the grassroots, as Alexander Stille was saying. You know, we've got history from documents, but we don't have the stories, the anecdotes, the survivors' testimony. I wonder if anyone had any comments on whether there's a different view from inside and outside Italy.
Well, I'll take a quick stab at this, as I'm not the expert on the panel, but just from my own most recent reading, there's a profound difference between the approach to this period by De Felice and by Mira Michaelis and Susan Zaccardi, whose entire book is built around survivors' narratives. And it's one after the other, name who helped, who did not, et cetera, et cetera. So, and that's in English. So, and Guri, you could help me with this. There's also a scholar, Liliana Picciotto, who has amassed the,
I just can't. It's not so much narrative, it's documentation,
right,
of the deportation.
Absolutely. So this is definitely happening. I'm sorry. This is definitely. Mm-hmm. Yes. Yes. Tell you, you want to. Okay.
If I may. There is also, I didn't have time. There is one thing that is interesting to me. There is, she mentioned Sarfatti, and Sarfatti is kind of the ghost behind Adler's preface. It's never mentioned openly, but it's obvious that
politics.
very sly, yeah. And but there's actually a third book, very different from De Felice, completely outside Italian political and cultural dynamics, and very different from Sarfatti. Not written by a Jew, not written in Italy. It is a book by Marianne Mattar Bonucci. You may like it or not like it, but that's a third narrative. And in many ways, it tries to face the things you say are lacking in the historiography, but that takes us elsewhere. But about different points of view. We're talking about an American and Italian. There's also a French debate. There's significant French historiography going on about these things, for example.
I have a question, I think, for the most of the public. I don't know if it's like, but let's say for people that are not scholars, but just general public, I would like to know if Italians were at the time, you know, racist, anti-Semitic or not, because like you say, oh, this book of De Felice, it's not usable today, not to give it to students, not to, I think when it came out, I mean, yes, probably today, but in the 60s at least, well, you know, to say that the Jewish community in Italy was the most integrated of all Europe was important. It means not everybody knew that we had prime minister, foreign minister, that we had a community that was very part of the Italian, of everything, in every sector of Italy, at least from when you read from the book, you find out certain, and again, not from scholars' point of view, from general public. And so my question is, how did it, and I would like an answer because, you know, the criticism on the book, it was strong and probably appropriate, but I want to know then the answer. How did it happen, 1938, and it happened because the Italian were prone to this anti-Semitism, or was it like a kind of a coup, was imposed to them? I only remember this, I have a testimony, maybe that answer also to that question. I remember an Edo Fiano testimony that he did here in New York that impressed me very much because he remembered when he was a child in Florence in 1938, a little like a teenager, and the day after the promulgation of the laws, just the day after, not talking about like, you know, after months, he remembers, at least that's what his testimony, he say, I went out and I was going to school and I felt like I thought I was a ghost. People was not seeing me. I was walking, I say hi, and people were just turning around. So again, the question, were Italians anti-Semitist, racist or not?
I'll take a stab at it. I mean, I don't know that that's really the crucial question. I think on a personal level, I say this, for example, based on many people that I interviewed, based on my own family that lived through the period, that in general, if there were some sort of thermometer that measured the virulence of anti-Semitism, Italy would rank low on that scale. It doesn't mean that it didn't exist. It was there. It was part of, as I mentioned, some of these things that you see in some of these Mussolini articles, and you see, for example, I think you mentioned, Professor Adler, that neither Mussolini or Ciano were particularly anti-Semitic, but Ciano never fails to mention that someone is a Jew in his diary when he meets with them. So there's a certain mild level, but there was plenty of anti-Semitism in the United States at the same time, possibly more. So that isn't the determining factor, but the point is there's something usable in the culture that can be made more salient, less salient, depending on the political needs of the moment. The political needs of the moment changed in the mid-30s as Italy moved into Ethiopia, tried to create an empire, decided to intervene with the fascists in Spain, and made the decision that Hitler was the future of Europe, and he threw in his lot to that. And therefore, anti-Semitism became politically useful. I don't think it was because it was bubbling up. Clearly, it wasn't bubbling up in the culture. But the fact that there's something there, that there's this long, tragic 20th century history of anti-Semitism means there's a usable something in the culture that can then be manipulated for political purposes. Many people didn't buy it, some people did, but that isn't really the determining factor.
But on this, Felice was right.
No, he wasn't totally wrong. The problem is he tends to downplay it more than is necessary. He has a point in early on in the book where he says Mussolini wasn't really anti-Semitic. He says this thing about where he, as I mentioned, I quoted this thing where he refers to this tirade against the Jews as an oversimplification. That's not an oversimplification. It is the protocols of the Elders of Zion recycled. And so that's part of his cultural baggage. He doesn't need it. He's an opportunist. So if he wants to leave it behind when he meets with Chaim Weizmann to make an alliance with the Zionists, to leave it behind. But if it's useful, he can bring it out and use it in conversations with Hitler, whomever. So it's just there. It's part of the culture. It can be more salient, less salient, but it's not the critical thing. Italy doesn't have the racial laws because people are crying in the streets for justice against the Jews. That's not what's happening. In that sense, I think as political analysis, it is fundamentally external factors that drive it. But it doesn't mean, it's not a either or thing. There is something in the culture that can be used and is used.
Well,
That's the way I see it.
Just very, very quick. I think you got a key point there. If you look at it, nowhere in Europe you have racial persecutions and racial laws because the people are crying for that under the offices of the prime ministers or the kings or the Führer. Everywhere it's a political choice that plays on a series of elements that are there in the culture and the climate. What I want to say is that, and that works for Mussolini personally and for the society as a whole, I don't think you can be ontologically an anti-Semite or not. You work into anti-Semitic rhetoric, practices, but that doesn't mean you're it forever or you're not and you're immune to it. And Mussolini used them, he came when he needed them, he was out of them when he didn't, but I think that's how you should look at it.
It's more a comment than a question, actually. And it's related to the way in which the discussion was held on the book of De Felice. There are two orders of problem. There is the publication of the book for the Italian public, and there is the publication of the book in America in 2016. And the two things, they don't go together. For as far as regards Italy, the problem of the book is related to the interpretation of fascism that gives De Felice in the book. And the presence of the Jews, they reflect his interpretation of fascism. He writes a defasticization of fascism, De Felice. He's not making a banalization of this book. This book is not banal at all. And there is a precise reason beyond the one that I were mentioned in 1961. And then there is the publication on this book for the American public. So in regards to the historical memory, the question is not if there are anti-Semite or not anti-Semite. It's not that there is one thing and that there is not the other things. The things that go together, and it's so true for fascist regime and for the Mussolini policy, that from the in 1919, and just to remind the book of the sacralization of politics of Emilio Gentile, when it opens up to the creation of the fascist man, reading that short paragraph, he explained precisely the acceleration of the regime afterwards in the persecution of the Jews. But the fact that the regime was a racist regime, and in this I don't think that, for example, for the last things that Guri said, that is only a question of politics. There is a difference between Nazism and fascism, that they are always played against each other in relation to the extermination of the Jews. You don't have to arrive to Auschwitz in order to explain the regime. You have to stand before to the racist law, not the racial law, because as Sarfatti corrected the language, he doesn't speak about racial law, rather racist law. This is the important thing. And there was on this a profound consensus inside Italian society. There was a consensus in the, on the extermination of the Jews? That is another question. But on 1938, the regime arrived to a situation where the racist law were there to be implemented. And it doesn't really matter how much racist or anti-Semite was Mussolini, how much he loved the Jews or didn't love the Jews. Most of the Nazi leadership, except Streicher, that he was the writer of the Stummel, well, they were not virulent anti-Semites. And then you killed 6 million people. The question is, how comes that you can kill so many people without hating them so much? So it's not a question of looking for hate all the time. This book is problematic because it presents a fascism in a way that Tim Mason, back in the 70s, we don't have to arrive in 1986, we have to look at the debate in the 70s in Italy, when Tim Mason said there was the
the special trials, and there was the economic modernization of Italy. There were the two things, they went together. You don't have to look for one and the other does not exist, because otherwise you don't get any, no, a comprehensive understanding of the phenomenon. Now why in 2016 in America they are publishing or republishing this book? This is another question that has nothing to do with Italy, that rather has to do with America. But why you are deciding not to publish or use the book of Michele Salfati that is far more advanced from an historiographic point of view, not from a political point of view?
It has been published in English.
Yes, it has been published in English, but if I understand correctly, this book should go to high schools or to students?
Yes.
Okay, exactly. That's what I'm saying. So what is the reason? Where is the point of when you are talking about historical memory on oblivion?
I think that this was exactly the point, and it's not why we're, of course, it's interesting to discuss historiography, but why is there an interest in America today, in which obviously the Jews become central and not by their own choice, because the Holocaust Museum has been somehow invited to put its name on this book, in looking at fascism in a way that somehow rehabilitates many of its elements?
Well, I think an answer is simply what we're doing in this room right now. Yes, this book says a lot about its publication history in Italy, but its publication in 2015 has to do with the fact that look at the passions that it has elicited in this room.
Of course, because it's a scandal.
It's not okay, just a publication. But I understand. I understand, but books are not published because they're quote unquote true. History books are republished. History books are republished because they continue to generate needed discussion. No one in this room could possibly argue that the historiography of Italian anti-Semitism, fascist anti-Semitism, was not irrevocably changed by the publication and the scandals and the political implications, machinations that Guri pointed out. The historiography has immeasurably been changed and benefited. It forced people to respond. It forced narratives of the Jews themselves, not simply the top down. It forced, in the case of Sarfati's book, to look very clearly at the systematic targeting of Jews right from 1922 and not magically in 1938. It looked at, for instance, those that are looking at church history and how the treatment of the Jews in the liturgy softened the ground for the acceptance of these racial laws, or at the very least, the acquiescence. All of this is a consequence of the scandals. And just anyone who's done modern European history in an undergraduate level, a quick example, A.J.P. Taylor, The Origins of the Second World War, that, in fact, Hitler didn't really start World War II, it was the appeasers in Britain and France. Well, even he didn't believe it, but it generated a discussion which was incredibly helpful for the origins of World War II. Neil Ferguson's The Pity of War, that somehow try to rewrite the experience of World War I. Not necessarily a consensus, but it generated discussion. So this is the value of the book, and in my mind. And let me just pass this over to anyone else now. Thank you very much for your patience.
No. I'm going to say, I think the book has extreme value for scholars, specialists who know the background, know its history, can read between the lines. Great. It was already there for scholars and specialists. It's not a first edition in English. What is troubling is the idea that this is presented as the textbook on the subject when it's 28 years old research. And you don't like Sarfatti very well. I can criticize Sarfatti in many ways. There's Matar Bonucci. You don't like Matar Bonucci, you can find something else. But using a 28-year-old book, as presenting it as the textbook on the subject, is really, really hard to understand, especially because in these 28 years, there wasn't a little bit of scholarship. There was a flood of scholarship that really transformed everything. But and that is
into presenting it as the textbook? No.
It is printed. It is printed as the textbook.
Absolutely.
I wasn't criticizing you. I was criticizing the operation.
Whoa, hold on. Because we don't have... Hold it. We don't have two things. One, people are talking over it. And two, we're not getting it clearly on tape. And that's very important.
So just one response. I'm not taking any of this as criticism of certainly me. Absolutely not. But the very point of having an historical appraisal and a panel of scholars here is to discuss the political machinations.
What's not discussed is that.
Hold on.
No, I mean, one thing that's not been addressed is precisely the imprimatur by the United States Holocaust Museum on this book. And I think that if we don't talk about that, we don't understand why these reactions. And I think that the reaction is precisely in the press release for the book and in this imprimatur. And I'd really appreciate some comment on that.
Hold on. We're going to have one question here. One back there, one there, and one here.
Thanks to the panelists for a very stimulating discussion and really a good discussion. I want to make a comment or two on the continuity and change issue, which in many ways is maybe the most basic historical issue, or at least often is. I was struck some years ago when I was doing research in the Archivio Centrale by a consistent strain, and I wasn't looking for this, a consistent strain of anti-Semitism in the line that was going from fascist agents abroad into the leadership of the political police in Rome to the head of the police, Bocchini, and then from there to Mussolini. And for that, this is from the early 30s, 31 onwards, for that to be there, the agent had to be comfortable that the upper hierarchy would be comfortable with seeing these gratuitous anti-Semitic comments. So that's one comment. Secondly, one of the other basic issues that De Felice was on one side of, and I couldn't disagree with him more, is that question of the comparison and contrast of Italian fascism and Nazism. And like anything else, you can compare and contrast. There are some ways they're similar, some ways they're different. I think they are much more similar than they are different. And the core of that is the fanatical hostility to liberalism there in both of them. And that hostility to liberalism can lead Mussolini comfortably into where he goes in the late 30s. I thought Alexander laid out that question of background very, very well. And what he was saying is that there's a fundamental aspects that are there early, but they're not dominant within Mussolini's actions within his context, and context change. So thank you, but thank you again for a stimulating panel.
Yes, first of all, I want to thank everybody for their very illuminating discussions up there. Especially, I wanted to thank, it's Professor Schwarz. You're not a Martian. You may feel like one, but I want to thank you for bringing up alluding to the illusion of objectivity, total objectivity, and the inability of any historian or journalist, for that matter, from separating themselves from their own historical, social, and political perspective, whether they're conscious of it or not. First of all, I wanted to get your reaction. I wanted to start off just by saying that there was a documentary several years back, maybe more than several years back, called The Righteous Enemy. I think it was partially funded by Yad Vashem. And the term, the righteous enemy, has been used to refer to Italy during the Second World War. That may have had as much, if not more, to do with Italy's dealings, particularly the military and the diplomatic corps, with Jews outside of Italy, in southern France and Yugoslavia. And what this leads into, what I'm really asking is, well, first of all, what percentage of Italy's Jews survived the war? And of the ones who didn't survive, what percentage were arrested or deported after the Nazi occupation of Italy, after Italy surrendered and were occupied? And to what degree the term the righteous enemy would be correct?
For the overall percentage of survival, I don't remember the exact number. I can tell you one thing. The percentage, I don't remember.
It used to be, traditionally, it was marked as 14% if you count there being 50,000 Jews in the country. But the figure has been sort of revised upwards because many Jews had fled to the south of the country and were not really covered by the German occupation. So I think current figures now put it in the 20-25% range.
That were
deported. So the survival rate was high compared to most countries in Europe. But of course, it's important to remember that the German occupation was much shorter in most parts of Italy than in many countries. You can't really compare it to Poland, which survived 5 years of Nazi occupation, where the rates were.
What I wanted to say is that I didn't remember the exact date, but I remember this point that is very, very much stressed by a recent book by colleague and friend Simon Levi Sullam, whose title in English would be The Italian Perpetrators. And he stresses that if you look at the percentages, as I said, I don't remember the exact numbers, but he says the comparison, which is interesting. He says, compare the percentage of survival in Italy and in France, and look, the difference is not that high. You survive a little more in Italy, it's around 4% more overall. But if you consider that persecutions begin a lot earlier in France, this somehow compensates, and you consider the overall situation in Italy. But the whole issue of how much they survive in Italy compared to other countries is to a very high degree a non-issue, okay? When you want to understand fascist anti-Semitism, I think that your problem is not to compare and contrast with a scale that is set at Auschwitz, okay? Auschwitz is not the scale for measurement of anti-Semitism. Luckily, historically, Auschwitz is the exception. It's not the norm. So the fact that fascist anti-Semitism did not tend to that end point until very, very late is not weird or doesn't make it less terrible or less serious in any way. I think that what if we want to understand what fascist anti-Semitism is, we have to more than concentrate on the terrible, terrible things that happened between 43 and 45, which are extremely relevant. We have to look at what happened before, between 38 and 43, in which you have a racist legislation that is implemented very, very systematically with the substantial acceptance of the majority of the population. That's the issue. And without a plan to kill the Jews. But you can be anti-Semitic and racist without planning to kill the Jews. It was the fascist, Mussolini's strand way, interpretation, call it whatever you want. It was the fascist way. And it's not more lenient because it's not the Nazi way, it's simply another way.
So I say this fully as not an expert, but also as a historian in training of modern Italy. And my first question is, they're kind of interrelated. As a historian of Italy or working on the history of Italy, I feel like within the historiographical tradition, you at some point must engage with Renzo Di Felice's work. And part of that is related to our issue of we're we seem to be having the same conversations. And to what extent are we kind of stuck in the Renzo di Felice moment? And then my second question, which is related, is I did my education both in Italy and in the United States, and I've recently concluded some very, very cursory research on eugenics in Italy. And 1938, rather than 1922 or any earlier date, gets placed within that literature, in my experience, in my very limited, as this changing moment, and that there's this backlash against it by the scientists, the eugenicists, that signed the manifesto. So my question is, you know, are these kind of phenomena interrelated?
Eugenics, when does it start? When? Okay, we are talking about the end of the 19th century. Okay, when Cesare Lombroso writes, and which when we are talking. So when you are talking about the eugenics, what kind of eugenics are you talking about? Okay, but they are late, and they are predecessor of this question of the race. That is go through all Europe. I think that Sandro said something like that about the presence of the study of race in other places as well.
Yeah.
But there's also a difference between the 20s and the 30s.
I'm sorry.
In which eugenics was related to hygiene, exercise, and stuff like that, that need not be racist.
Well, I disagree with it, because in this country, for example, the policy of abortion against black women started exactly with the eugenics, and in the 20s and also in the 30s.
I'm not defending eugenics.
I'm simply saying there's a significant
difference between discussions in the 20s and discussions from the mid-30s on over what that signified in terms of fascism, in terms of Italy's future.
There was a reading, I believe it was of Mussolini's letter to the Jews, saying that, you know, Italy had never been an anti-Semite country, and as long as they kind of like played along, that would, someone said it would be a warning. I'm just curious as to how Zionism and un-Zionism or non-Zionism played out in any type of schisms and was taken advantage of, or national Jewishness versus international Jewishness. How was this taken advantage of from without, from within? How did those schisms play out, and then how does that compare to how it played out maybe in Germany?
I happen to have written a lot about that, but I'll make it brief. But it was used, first of all, for Italy, and not just in Italy. The same was to some degree true in France, but in Italy and certainly within fascist Italy, the idea of having a double identity and a double national loyalty was seen badly. And so the Zionists were under suspicion and occasionally came under attack by some of the anti-Semitic writers of the period. And Mussolini used this from time to time, and that was part of this kind of conditional loyalty that I was referring to in that essay. And so that it worked very destructively within the Jewish community, because what happened is when the Jews began to fear that what was happening in Germany might happen in Italy, you had the formation of an anti-Zionist newspaper that was referred to early, La Nostra Bandiera, which went about targeting the Zionists. And basically, the argument was, unless these people stop doing what they're doing, we're all going to be in trouble. So stop being a Zionist. Your homeland is here in Italy, and you've got to stop. Zionism has to be purely humanitarian. movement to help victims of pogroms in Russia, not for Italian Jews, to develop a second set of loyalties. And so that in this kind of tragic misperception, the basic tragedy of this is that these Jews were under the delusion that anti-Semitic policy would depend on their good behavior or bad behavior, which was a fundamental misunderstanding. It had nothing to do with their behavior. It had to do with Mussolini's politics. So then when the racial laws were passed, one of the more deluded members of this group actually led a punitive mission to Florence and attacked the offices of the Zionist newspaper. And so that's sort of how that played out. But as I said, there exists more detailed account of it if you want to know more about it.
Thanks, everybody, for coming. Thank you, panelists, for coming. And arrivederci alla prossima puntata.